Salil Ramaswamy, who is currently the CEO of two notable blockchain companies, Yen Investment Company.
Yeah, so that's Focus Investments, and I'm a managing partner.
Okay, phenomenal. But now your waking hours are primarily focused on Blockgenic and getting into a strong position as a candidate to become a block producer for the EOS blockchain.
Yes.
Okay, and competition, based on what I can surmise so far, I'm fairly new to EOS, so I hadn't been previously really following the project closely. But it looks like there are just over 100, close to 100 candidates.
Oh, yeah.
Now for only 21 spaces.
Yeah. Now, actually, it's close to like 200, I think.
Whew.
Yeah.
That escalated quickly.
It's growing really quickly. Yeah. It's just the last couple of weeks has been kind of crazy. Lots of new candidates, you know. So.
Okay. So, I mean, just in terms of the sheer numbers, right? Numbers game. You are, any new entrants into the block producer candidate space are hoping that only one of 21 available spots will be theirs. They can't occupy more than one spot, for example.
Yes, only one of 21. And then there's also another 30 to 40 spots for standby BPs too. So
okay. The
way the system works is at any one time, there'll be 21 of active block producers, like producing blocks on the EOS network. And then you would have like another 50 who are waiting on the sidelines. They still get paid by the network. They would have the infrastructure that's same as the main 21, but they are just there in case, for whatever reason, either technologically one of the 21 fail or they keep dropping blocks, they'll get voted out and one of the standbys would swap in. Or if they do something wrong and they become unpopular, you know, so you always hear mining, you know, with mining, like there's all these controversies and, you know, some of the miners act like, you know, like in unsavory ways, right?
Oh, but yeah. Right now I'm prepping content on Walton Chain. And Walton Chain, because of the way that their nodes are structured, their master nodes and their grandmaster nodes, it is very possible to show favoritism in that space. So each blockchain is, depending on how blocks are awarded or how tokens are awarded, there are an infinite number of ways to be corrupt.
That's right. So when something like that happens, they can get watered out. But still, it's not a perfect system. I think the idea that you would come up with some magical system to eliminate like the bad behavior is a kind of a misnomer. It's just going to show up in different forms somewhere else, you know. So this is, they're kind of like doing this. I think the biggest push for EOS is just this massive ICO. Like that they have. So they have like a lot of like, you know, cash backing them. I think, you know, like whatever said and done, that is like a big advantage, you know, because what they're doing is actually they're seeding a lot of venture capital fund. Mm-hmm. And that's a great way to like attract. I think blockchain is going to kind of, it's so powerful. It's going to take on so many different forms and it's going to go into a lot of different niches, right? I think EOS definitely fills one of those niches, which is more like, it's kind of centralized in a bit. It's kind of like a more of a hybrid, you know, between like totally centralized and like, let's see where it goes. But the most important part is the governance part. You know, I think it's something cool.
Yes. Well, let's come back to that in a minute. But first, let's jump way back. You mentioned something that was the first question that I started to get from people in private forums and publicly. Everyone wants to know, and I told them, hey, this is a block producer. This isn't somebody who's directly on the EOS project. So, but the top question that everybody has is, where'd all the money go? Where's $4 billion? How's it being used? And I guess I should ask, just in the context of being a block producer,
right?
To what extent could you answer that? Or is it pure speculation, or is it really not a good time to even discuss that in your role?
It's fine. I think so Block One did the ICO as a company incorporated outside of the United States, right? Just because ICOs, you cannot, I think both Chinese and, if I'm right, Chinese and US investors are quote unquote blocked, you know? So so they raised all that money, you know, a lot of investors, you know, I think basically like a lot of crypto investors who made a lot of money in the previous iterations, you know, who had a lot of, you know, so there's a lot of money to go around. So they ended up raising because of all the price increase, like now close to $4 billion. A lot of that, they're just seeding it back to the ecosystem through venture capital funds. So they've made partnerships with actually Eric Schmidt's Tomorrow Ventures, I think. And then there's a number of big cryptocurrency venture funds who are actually getting money from Block One to seed investments, basically startups into EOS. So it's actually an interesting way to approach this, as in like building out the network is the most valuable thing right now. Like technology, as much as there is innovation, in 2000, here's a, like an interesting way to see this. 2008, Bitcoin, the technology was super valuable. There was nothing else like it before. It was first of its kind and it was groundbreaking. And then like not many people understood. So that piece of technology, the code, was super valuable. Now fast forward 10 years, there is so many clones and, you know, a lot of innovation too, but there's a lot of clones, whatever, right? Now I've seen—
Ask Charlie Lee how he feels about that term.
Right, right. Yeah, no, people are like—
He was the first to be second.
You're right. Yeah, and that was a good time actually to clone things, if you're, you know, that's the first clone. So, but then, you know, after 10 years, I feel like value in the technological innovation on the blockchain has kind of like dropped to the— I mean, what I mean by this, it's still valuable, but what I mean by that is that they're all incremental changes. And
right, yeah, nothing's truly transformative, it seems like.
Yeah, nothing's truly transformative. And even if that's the case, I don't know if that has as much mileage as it would have in 2008. Now, the real mileage now comes from network and adaption. Like, okay, who can get the real, like the real world, you know, there's a bunch of my friends who just don't know anything about this, right? And I'm sure you have too. So,
oh yeah,
who's going to get to those people? I think we are at the stage like right there. And then suddenly Block One comes along, it has $4 billion in cash and it's starting to like invest with other venture capital funds to bring them. You're also kind of bringing venture, but if you go give them so much money, they're suddenly interested. One, they get more money, so they want to, you know, invest in other startups to bring them onto the space. Venture capitalists, as much as I like, you know, like people, a lot of people don't like them, you know? So
they're like any other business person, right? They've got their considerations and they have their, right, their desires, their hopes, their fears.
That's right. The positive side of having venture capital people is that they vet a lot. Like what they have a very good vetting pipeline for projects.
Yeah.
Now that's an interesting thing to plug into a blockchain ecosystem. Now blockchain ecosystem, we are so used to being open and like, you know, anybody can come build. It's still the case. It's still the case. Now suddenly you have a few billion dollars that's being funneled through venture capital pipeline into the ecosystem. Now it'd be interesting to see over the next 5 years what that means. You know, could one of these projects actually like create the next Google? Because we are still don't have— the closest we have to Google are like the exchanges. You know, exchanges, you know, Coinbase, it's pretty, it's kind of going big, you know. But then I haven't seen like many other projects that's actually kind of like gaining like real world adoption. We have—
well, I think Telegram, to name one project that I think has potential. Telegram,
right.
Yeah, Telegram, I think they were, the Telegram open network, I think that they were really gunning for that next big thing moniker, right?
That's right.
But then they didn't go past their initial raise with the qualified investors to do what in 2017 we would consider an ICO, right? And they just said like, okay, it's not really an ICO. It's just a typical raise. We got enough. We're just going to roll with that.
Yeah.
But I'm with you in terms of being truly transformative. I think they have adoption and they have user base.
I agree.
And that's great. But let's liken that to the horse that you lead to water. You can't make it drink crypto. You know?
That's right. That's right.
So yeah,
that's exactly true. So getting back to your question. Yeah. So they are— a bunch of the money is funneled back into the VC ecosystem, you know? And honestly, you don't need that much money to like build the crypto project or whatever, you know, they have a very robust team. And if you
having at the same time, though, you know, having dealt with development, it always takes more time and money than you think.
That's right.
You can't overfund development when you're talking about delivering something like even just getting to MVP that doesn't suck.
Yeah. Like, no, I agree.
Yeah, you can't overfund it.
They've definitely done a great job in terms of like the projects. In fact, when we wanted to become a block producer candidate, I just didn't like just go jump and decided to like spend my time on it. You know, we evaluated it quite we vetted it actually. And because there are other projects too, we could get involved with so many other projects, you know?
Well, let's talk really, really about some other possibilities that are out in the market right now. And let's go back to your process for vetting. I mean, I think we're at the point now, I don't think you're going to inform any competitors to jump in and try to like, try to devalue your work by oh, then we want to be Black producers too now. And Sulu gave us the roadmap, hey. right? I don't think I'm giving away any trade secrets now, but let's talk first about competing platforms. I thought it was very interesting. Mm-hmm. I tuned in. It was very interesting. Tron. Mm-hmm. I know. We're not going to dwell on it very long. But let's talk about Tron, and let's talk about some unique differences, because we're talking about platforms now, right? We're talking about not necessarily about transformative work a la Bitcoin 2008, but right. We're talking about frameworks and foundations now that these blockchain founders are hoping will invite the next radical transformation and invite the next true innovation. Mm-hmm. It's something as radical as Bitcoin was in 2008. I think that Justin at Tron, as their spokesperson, I think he's hoping to be able to at least be the face of the announcement when that happens. Mm-hmm. And that the whole team there is hoping to see something transformative happen there. Mm-hmm. And clearly everybody who's in the EOS camp is hoping that a massive, just radically disruptive and transformational technology will launch on EOS.
Right.
What are some key differences? What makes EOS a better,
right?
a more fertile ground than, say, Tron?
Yeah. Just kind of like a disclaimer first, like I've heard about Tron, but I haven't followed it that closely, so I might not know specifically. It could be like any other project, right?
Well, then let's talk about your vetting process and what brought you to EOS without even bringing up Tron too much in depth. I'm not asking you to defend your decision or stand on behalf of everybody that's chosen EOS over Tron. And from an investment standpoint, everybody wants a little bag of everything.
Yeah, for all you know, like who knows which is going to win? Like it's just speculation at this point. And like the way I would always go back to the same kind of thinking I've always done in the space, which is that I always look for what is scarce at any point in time. Okay, now what is scarce? So in 2008, it was the code. When Bitcoin was launched, there was nothing like it before. And so it was scarce. Scarce things are valuable. Now, 2008, you have thousands of projects. Now, unfortunately, that same piece of code is not that valuable anymore, you know? Now, what is valuable? It's networks. Now, what is scarce? Building a huge network of people to come support you, like make somebody give up their day, you know, or switch careers, God forbid, like to do something, like how easy is it? It's so much easier to fork a code or like build something. Relatively, I'm not by any means like devaluing anything.
Oh. No. You're absolutely right. I mean, AWS. I mean, I want to say that you can spin up Bitcoin clones with one button press.
That's right. You see it, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
So my thinking always is following what is scarce, you know. So right now, I feel network effect is the most scarce thing in the space. To the point where technologically, like what the coin does is almost like secondary. Now, having said that, EOS is a pretty good candidate technologically, I feel, but that's only secondary. Like just because if it probably had not been as good as it has been, I'll still just put that as my second consideration, just because, you know, you always can figure out a way to fix that. Now, what is great is that they have been able to build momentum across, like in China, Korea, like, you know, in the West, like you have like big teams kind of like interested, you know. And I also like the whole BP layer to it, you know, obviously to the point where I decided to become one, but
right,
the interesting thing is suddenly you have quote-unquote paid agents who are competing with each other. And essentially, you can think of them as like your like paid like sales people, you know. So just the nature of the competition between the BPs will make them one up each other in a very public way, to the point where each one will try to figure out a little niche to be, you know, to have like how are you going to stand out, and that's going to cause growth on itself. Like for me, actually, having followed the space like so closely for so many years, when I saw the whole BP idea, like that's why I thought, oh my God, like it's so cool. Like you can kind of become a representative, you know? Usually it's a, like either you start the ICO for the blockchain, you're part of the company, you know? It's, or usually they do like bounties and stuff to incentivize people to do stuff.
Right.
But like, I think the way the BP thing will evolve is you actually would become like big companies by itself. You're indirectly tied to the success of EOS, obviously, but essentially like there's a scope for the block producers to kind of come in and be like a powerful people to push this forward. So that's one aspect of it, just that small difference. And then the fact that they do have like one of the most successful ICOs of all time, you know, that money definitely helps. And then I've been traveling. Actually, I was in Korea like a couple of weeks ago, and I'm actually going to China next week.
Nice.
Yeah. So to go meet all these other candidates, and you'd be amazed at like how well set up some of these teams are, like in Korea and China. So suddenly you have this huge global network of pretty well-funded teams, like instantly. Like, you know, if you get into the ecosystem, you have all these connections, and there is a bunch of venture capital money waiting on the sideline to fund good ideas. And like that, all this combination of things, I feel like EOS, it makes EOS very powerful, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm sure there are other ones too. Like I'm to the point where I'm kind of like, one of my regrets is that I'm so focused on EOS now, I'm kind of like not following everything else that much.
You're getting a little out of touch maybe.
Out of touch, yeah, and that's the thing. Like you, that's the trade-off. You know, it's a sad part, but at least now, you know, I'm able to like look into this deeply. You know,
right? That's awesome. Well, let me do this. I'm gonna share the screen here. This is the Blockgenic website, and this is what people would see. Now, you've aligned this company, Blockgenic. You've aligned your current interests, and like you said, what EOS has done that is admirable is that they've gotten you right to give up days and nights and to travel. And to proselytize, right?
Yeah.
And to talk about as a platform why this is a great seedbed of innovation. So right. The next person to create something transformative, a la Bitcoin in 2008, right. That you're now saying it for them. You're lending them your megaphone to say, "Hey, come make the next Bitcoin 2008 here in EOS."
Yes. Yeah. That's exactly right.
How can people who are just checking out Blockgenic? How can they be supportive of that? If they're just coming in, or what questions should they ask?
Sure.
Like, how do they even approach you? I'm using the website as one example, but is that the best way?
Yeah, no. So, you know, so we usually have people like, we have our email. Usually people get in touch with us through that. And what we do is actually, if you go up to the top,
okay.
There's a bunch of like, so if you see Meetup, we run our Meetup, if you click on that, we run our Meetup events, we do community events up in Seattle. So we have about 340 members and we run like monthly events.
Nice.
So we have like, usually we have members of Block One who come to give talks and we invite like other, you know, people who are doing interesting projects in the space. We have them like present. Our outreach has been, so again, that's the other interesting part of the BP thing. You know, because I was running the fund, we did try to get involved with events and stuff, but not like this. Like this really, just the process itself puts us right in center in terms of like building out a community. And it's actually kind of much easier than trying to build out a community on your own from scratch, because EOS has a great lot of interest. So it's kind of like helps both ways. So we help build out the EOS community in Seattle, and we do like our events there. We try not to talk about like ourselves that much. We try to keep it to the website.
Oh, sure. Okay. That makes sense. That's kind of what I'm curious about. Because you mentioned before, like you're working on promoting EOS as a platform and as a framework.
Right.
Or it's not right. That's not even the right way of saying that. I know, because it's not like Ethereum where it's like it is functionally a programming framework.
Yeah. It is a technological stack. You know, like you can kind of like you can already build prototype on it, and there's a lot of platforms who are already using a lot of apps who are a lot already using to prototype on it. The only thing is the blockchain hasn't launched, but there's been testnets and stuff that the developers can work on. So on our end, what we do is we've actually kind of partnered with the University of Washington, and then there's going to be a global hackathon in middle July where a lot of these BP candidates are all pitching in money, and we're going to be like, there's a community-driven event, and we're going to be running it in Seattle. So there's like going to be close to $30,000 price pool, and it's going to be like live coordinated across the globe because, you know, we are in Seattle, right? So there's candidates in New York, Seoul, Beijing, Shanghai, London, Dublin, like wherever. So that's what I was kind of like getting to, you know, in the beginning, like that kind of stuff. Like, you know, so we dedicate our time in Seattle. We cannot do everything, you know. So we do like our part, and suddenly you can plug into this network, and they're all running events. They're going to be live events. So most probably we were thinking of plans of cross telecasting. It's almost, it will be like a almost like a New Year celebration, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Just it'll be like time zones are different.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Okay, so it sounds like then these are some of the events then that you have going on, and this is probably the most public way then that
that we interface. Yeah, that's right. That's the most public way, and we try to like kind of also you know, talk about EOS to a lot of our enterprise like large enterprises that we have connections with, I was at DreamWorks for a while, and then my co-founder, he was at Microsoft, and just through that we have like a lot of connections in the industry, in both in the media and technology industry. They're all kind of interested in like blockchain, right? But they don't know exactly like what to do or how to enter. Now trust is an important factor there, and like, you know, just from my background, like, you know, so people who trust me, like when I tell them about this, they go like, okay, yeah, why don't we got to try something, like, why don't we like try what Sulu is, he seemed to be like doing something, you know, so they want to listen. That,
got it.
Again, each of the BP candidates are going to like have their own circles, you know, like,
yeah.
I wouldn't easily like promote something, honestly, you know, like, because, you know, that's something I take seriously. You know, it's just putting my name behind something. So, and that's why even though we always did the funds and stuff, like we were always kind of like behind the scenes. I always hesitated to go behind any specific project. Now I thought EOS, if I was going to do one, it's probably going to be with EOS. Still a risk, but I feel comfortable taking that on.
Based on the conversation we've had so far, I mean, that speaks volumes about why you're putting yourself in this position of candidacy to become a blockchain or a block producer for EOS.
Right.
Yeah, because everything you said before, like the culmination of all of your journey in crypto, right? From investing to then investing others' money, and to being early on projects, but not allowing yourself to become like intoxicated or infatuated with projects.
Yeah.
Speaks volumes about actually why you'd be a great block producer.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
At the helm of a company that would make a great block producer in terms of culture, and not being like, okay, well, it's all EOS and there's nothing else, and why would you look at them?
That's no, I agree. And I, you know, again, I think you know, another thing I noticed was like from 2008, if you see roughly at every 5 years you get some kind of like a next stage evolution. It took about 5 years between Bitcoin to Ethereum. Ethereum was launched in 2013, right? And then from 2013 to EOS is like another 5 years. Now Ethereum definitely improved on Bitcoin's core infrastructure, right? It made smart contracts like super useful, and it created the whole ICO thing. Then now I think EOS, not just EOS, there's a few other projects too, but they're all kind of like starting to introduce governance into the blockchain.
Yeah.
And I think this is just an evolutionary phase. It is just that it's a new step at governance, EOS. I think in another 5 years, we'll see a new and better version of it. And I don't know if it just would be some version of EOS or something else. That's hard to predict. But here's what the key thing though, like when you see something new in blockchain space, you got to get involved. Because the next version will be much better. And if you have, imagine like being a Bitcoin developer in 2008. Do you think that it's wasted effort, right? Same thing. I see like kind of getting involved with governance as that. Like I don't know. I don't think end goal is EOS or like it's definitely going to do a lot of good things, and we want to help make it happen. But it's just getting enrolled at this time and trying to learn it, you know.
Brilliant, absolutely. Got to get your hands dirty.
Yeah.
So awesome. I told you we would do about an hour, and it's about 6 o'clock your time. So I don't want to impose. Can we do a bonus round and talk just a little bit about some real world uses and maybe just overall direction for blockchain? Because I mentioned before we started live streaming and then before we started recording that it seems like, man, people have just gotten so tired of ICOs in general. In 2018, it's practically the only four-letter word, right? It's ICO.
Yeah.
It's sad, but it's gotten a really bad name.
That's right. Yeah.
And so people are just kind of tired of security tokens because every other ICO coming out it's almost like they use the exact same theme, bootstrap theme or whatever, right? And then they're like, the future of money again. Okay.
Yeah.
How everyone's the future of money, apparently. You know, 1,500 times the future of money.
Yeah.
So the utility, this idea of utility blockchain and being able to move past digital currencies as a store of value, because frankly, the current fiat systems are technically digital currencies. Technically.
Right. Yeah,
There's nowhere near enough printed money to cover the money supply in the world.
That's right. That's right.
We already have digital currency. That's not new. It doesn't. Right. And like you said, in terms of scarcity, Bitcoin being a digital currency wasn't what was scarce.
Right.
It was the decentralization. It was the openness of the distributed ledger. There are all these other things that were scarce and new.
Right.
So now we're looking at utility blockchains. That's kind of what people are saying is scarce and new, like a la, you know, vis-a-vis Ethereum. And now you're saying governance to figure out how is this being directed and who is choosing.
Yeah, good. It's definitely that the governance is an interesting new area. And I don't know if it's going to, I definitely think that there will be multiple stabs at it before it gets reasonable. There's a lot of conflicts with governance, especially governance around blockchain. And then there is local jurisdictions. Suddenly, when you can reverse transactions, then you get like all kinds of other, you open up another, like I was saying, like you just never, you can't invent a system that just suddenly gets rid of all the bad things. You know, it's just they appear in some other form somewhere else, you know?
Yeah.
It'll be interesting to see like what, you know, I think they have a noble goal in terms of like trying to integrate governance into blockchain. It'd be very interesting to see like where the problem areas are. And those are opportunities, in fact, right? So it's important for people like to kind of like pay attention to that, like kind of see how the governance, there'll be a lot of good things too. Like I really hate the idea that if you like miss like one character in some private key, like you'd lose like all that money, you know? All of us have probably like run into that scared, you know, get scared and scared at some point about some form of that. So it'll be interesting to like kind of get that out of the way. Hopefully that's, you know, I'm really looking forward to that day. And I think EOS might make that happen.
That alone would be enough of an innovation to say it was all worth it.
Oh yeah, 100%. Like I can kind of like, I would actually start to introduce like cryptocurrencies to a whole bunch of more friends, actually. I know a bunch of guys who I will not ask them to like buy Ethereum or something because I just don't trust them to like even move that money carefully, you know?
Nothing. And they come back and blame you. So look what I did, it's all your fault.
Yeah, you gotta be always careful about which friends you introduce to this space, you know? So I just feel like it just opens up that, you know, like more, it makes it more inclusive in a way. It's not, you know, I think there'll be like other areas where like having ability to reverse transactions might not be great. So you have to use that in a very, like the trust in the governance is super important in this case. And something that I feel like it's more important than the technology part of EOS, the blockchain part, and there's all this talk about the technology and launching the blockchain. I feel like that's part of it. The more important part is like how the governance is going to be implemented, like the trust. Like I always think of these as societies, you know, and I feel like Bitcoin and Ethereum, they're great in terms of introducing new concepts, but as a society, they're kind of ungoverned societies, you know? And EOS will be a governed society. Now, if they implement, like, there are kind of governance where like a bunch of your buddies run like the government, and you know, like that's usually like some kind of a dictatorship, right?
We've been there and done that in many countries.
Yeah, right. And so that's the thing. It's just kind of like seeing them as analogy to, it's almost like starting from blockchain and turning it into like some kind of a web society. We call them communities, but some kind of societies, you know, each with their own rules, each attracting. Before, we were all divided geographically across countries. Now, because of the internet, you know, we are all, can be anywhere, and you can choose to become part of any of these societies, right?
Yeah.
And I feel EOS has a stab at kind of making one of the more like fair, you know, well, okay, not to go on a tangent, but talk about US, you know, I always felt like one of the things, as much as like, you know, it's not a public system, but social mobility is great here, right? Like,
yeah.
When if you are talented, like compared, it could be better, but you know, compared to like a lot of places, if you're like talented and you're here, like you people still believe that, right? To a certain extent, you know. Now you map that to blockchains. You want to have blockchains where innovation has a lot of upward social mobility. Now, how you implement that, maybe you have governance, maybe you don't, all that are details. But we are going, like the most successful blockchain will be the blockchain that has this mobility, kind of like somehow it encourages that mobility. You know, if you're an adapt developer, maybe you go to some blockchain, like nobody gives a shit. Like suddenly you come to like, maybe it's EOS or some other blockchain, you come, and then suddenly you get funded and like you get all this support, you get users.
Yeah.
I think that's the vision, you know, and hopefully EOS does it. If not, something is going to do it.
Okay, that's awesome. So this is a great point in the conversation, because I totally agree. I think that without there being some kind of an incentive, and not necessarily profit motive, whether it's notoriety or some kind of social mobility in some meaningful way to the individual, right. So they feel drawn, right, and they feel anchored to the work that they're doing every day, or to the value that they're providing to humanity as a whole, or the network, as it were, the society. Right. Digital society, that this is super important, but governance is going to really be the key to unlock that. Because if, to use the US again as an example, great place to live, great place to vacation, but the grass is always greener. Right. People who live here say, well, our taxes are too high. You get punished for success. Actually, if you're in this narrow band of income that's between, you know, what we term successful and average, you get extra punished because now right. You're being priced out of certain services, premium services that you thought were yours because you had worked for them and you were given some kind of proof that that work had value, money.
Right.
And
right.
But it wasn't enough. So right. You feel held down. It seems to be a very common problem in the US.
Right.
And so everyone's saying like, I wonder how it is over there.
That's
or
right.
Or can I put my money offshore somehow? How can right. I protect what I'm working on? But then right. it winds up further breaking that system, right? Of generating, of exchanging value, right? In terms of work and then receiving it. Because right. now you're looking for ways to break the system and but not sustainable ways to break the system where it affects governance for others. You're kind of escaping and slamming the door behind you.
That's right. Yeah. No, and also like it's interesting, like now we all have a choice to be part of all of these like net societies of sorts. Now, it used to be just communities on Reddit and stuff. Now it's like more tied to money too. It's so interesting. It's going to become more stronger, you know, and as you kind of join these societies. And I think it'll be interesting to see like how there's going to be a lot of different versions of these too. I think EOS is somewhat of a plutocracy, to be honest.
Okay.
It's not a quote unquote democracy, you know, like it's just you kind of whoever controls most tokens kind of vote for the block producers, right? The thinking being that if you have more at stake, then you care more. It's more of your loss if something bad happens, right? Now, that's just one way of thinking. Like, I don't think there's just one way of devising a, you know, there's kind of like all these different ways to do it. So there's going to be a lot of experimentation and all of us would get to choose. The main difference, I think, now in the future would be we can get to be part of these, quote unquote, all these digital societies. You can be anywhere. Doesn't matter, you know, you can instantly you'll find your society, like, and you'll fit somewhere.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And if you can't find that society, just use a VPN.
That's right. You'll still find the guys who, if you seek something strong enough, you'll find it.
Well, let's take kind of a turn here, and let's talk a little bit less about just EOS per se, and let's talk about blockchain and possibilities for the future. Because you talked about how blockchain has myriad uses, and you talked a lot about governance. That's come up a lot in the conversation, which I really appreciate because, frankly, with the future of technology and with implementations of AI being somewhat, you know, performing such impressive tasks that are human directed still, but performing such impressive tasks and AI showing such great promise down the line, moving from symbolic systems to neural nets back to symbolic systems and seeing them do such amazing things, right. And automation to the point that, frankly, I mean, in Phoenix, right? Google is releasing their new driverless cars. It's happening today. People who doubted that it would happen,
right?
Their doubts don't matter because it's happening. So right. The question always remains, who directs all of this? It appears to be autonomous. It appears to be directed by computers, you know, a la AI.
Right.
Anybody right. who's reasonably educated on how computers and these systems works,
right.
they know it's always directed by someone. So who decides, yeah. right? Like that's right. governance is so important.
You know, that's true.
So it makes me wonder, uh-huh. what are the possibilities for blockchain? How is that going to affect in the future just some great ideas that people have had? What yeah. are some great ideas, for example, that you think could be facilitated by blockchain? And then sure. further, that bottom line question, who decides?
Yeah. So again, I think that's where like the governance part kind of kicks in. It's important to start experimenting with it because you know you can't build a well after you feel thirsty. You have to start building it way before, you know. So I think that's kind of what is happening here, which is good. Now going back to your question, I think as far as like you know, one of the things we did, you know, when we were looking at our site a while back, and like we just released like a white paper on UBI.
Mm-hmm.
I know.
Yeah, I'll be leaving a link to that below in the comments. So for anybody who's not familiar with UBI, Universal Basic Income,
yes.
and some phenomenal discourse that you've been continuing with that conversation. So.
Oh yeah, thank you. So we actually kind of like you know, speaking of like automation and stuff, that's something that I felt like just through the enrollment, the fund and stuff, like we didn't make a good money, you know, like so. Like we are at a point, like I personally at least at a point like where I want to really see like how there could be some meaningful impact. UBI is definitely one of those areas because not just UBI, I think in a broader sense, you have profit making corporations at one end, right? Now, obviously, as things we've seen with the Facebook and things like that, they're always the design of the corporation. It's actually wrong to blame the people involved because we are all victims of systems. I wouldn't say victims of systems, we are driven by systems, you know? And the corporate system is designed in a way that the people in it are motivated to make most profit for the stockholders, you know? They don't care about think of it as a machine. The machine is designed to go, if it finds green grass, it's going to go suck out the greenery, package it into product, make the most money and move on to the next place. You know, that's the system, you know?
Like a horde of locusts.
Yeah, basically, you know, like, and then it did have its use, you know, it survived for hundreds of years, you know, because it did something that was useful. And then, but it has bad side effects, as we are seeing. And then the other extreme is like governments, you know, like, you know, as much as people might hate them, they did kind of like, you know, when a lot of people got together, like they wanted a government to feel secure, you know, and I think they did their job. As much as they're not perfect, they did do their job, and societies are still around, you know. So there's the other extreme. Now, blockchain, I feel like, fits somewhere in the middle. Now, we never had something like this because money was always a very tightly controlled entity, commodity. So money is power, right? So it was always like the money system was not innovated for hundreds of years because it's kind of power. That's where the government gets its power, everything, you know? So now blockchain, Bitcoin kind of sneaked in and really open sourced money to a certain extent, you know? And then suddenly, like, we all have like all of these little like innovators coming out of nowhere doing all these different things. What I'm getting at is that blockchain, especially now you introduce governance into it, now you get to experiment with how the systems around money are built. Corporations is a system of around money. In effect, it's a very rigid system, and we know its task. Its task is to maximize like benefits for the stockholders. Now, when you introduce governance into blockchains, you get to experiment with a lot of different things. There, I feel like if the right group of people got together, you can actually have a more socially conscious profit-making entity. I would almost say call them, there again, there's a lot of fancy words for them, but it's basically digital cooperatives.
Okay.
It's like a cooperative.
So they are very different corporate structure, very different corporate structure. Even you're suggesting something that is by nature
community owned.
Yeah, community. They're not a corporation, but larger than a partnership.
Yeah. So essentially, the gist is that data, like Facebook owns the data, and then like Facebook stockholders profit from the user data, right? Now, blockchain can provide interesting structures where we all pool our personal data into a blockchain and then make money on that. So anybody who wants to use it, we get paid money. So we can monetize our own. And we there would be some kind of a company to like run this. But essentially, at the end of the day, you own your data, and your data is valuable, so you get some money. So with the UBI idea, it's like a lot of people, the idea is that everybody gets paid money so that you don't have to like jump between five different jobs to get by, and you have actually time to follow your other interests, right? Now, one of the biggest questions that a lot of UBI projects around the world run into is funding. You know, nobody can afford just keep giving people money.
Right.
That's where something like blockchain would be super useful, because you could kind of suddenly get all of our data in one place, and then you could give people money from that data as like, say, advertiser or is making use of the data instead of Facebook stockholders.
Got it. So something along the lines, based on the examples that you used, be something along the lines of a social network that has an ongoing crypto faucet.
Yeah, something like
that. For all users or participants. Right. That's awesome. Yeah, very cool. So I wanted to bring that up because I saw the white paper that you did on UBI. And again, I just think it's so important for people to be educated on this, because it's not, I think, a very common topic of conversation.
Sure.
Certainly in the United States, I think it's equated with welfare systems, which I think in a lot of states, actually EU states, it's equated with welfare. Nordic states, apropos of the embedded videos that you had on the Medium channel, they right. discuss it in that context of welfare, because you have to consider, you know, the worst case scenario, right, where the most value could be given to somebody that has nothing.
That's right.
And then, you know, to level the amount that's given in universal care for universal
right.
basic income.
Right.
But I think in the United States, it's often sloughed off as like, I don't want to talk about that. I worked hard for this. I don't want to give it to anybody else. It's so very...
Right.
And I mean, even on folks who are politically left-leaning,
right,
in this country, culturally, there's a strong culture of bootstrapping and DIY and independence, right? Not interdependence,
right? Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Not codependence.
Yeah. That's right.
Independence.
Independence. That's right. Yeah, yeah.
I don't
yeah.
need you. I don't want you. I want my own.
That's
everything.
Right. That's right. And you know, like I think a lot of that actually, you know, obviously. There is reasons for people to believe all different points of view. The thing that you have to really consider is what you were talking about, automation, AI, all of that kind of kicking in. It's going to be really unfair, like, to build a society around the, like, you know, right now a job is almost your identity. You know, like, yeah. for a lot of, like, for yeah. the last so many decades.
Well, so Lou, on that note, I apologize for interrupting so soon. On that note, there's a large percentage of jobs in the United States, even, and in many developed nations throughout the world, a large percentage of jobs, at least for adult males,
right,
that are, the description is drivers.
Right.
They are, yeah. they drive in transportation, whether it was taxi, now Uber, Lyft, right. other such driving systems. The reason they exploded was because it was a way to make additional income. But
that's right.
There's a huge percentage where there are more, I'll put it this way, more adult males in the United States who share that job description of driver than share any other job description.
That's right. Sure. Yes. And now we see all these automation efforts going on, and like, you know, So you can see like where something needs to be done, you know, and it's like a complex problem. I don't think one person can solve it, but that's why like some of the, it's almost like some of these bigger blockchains are in a good spot to do that, you know, and as block producers, we felt like we can start some conversations around there. We spoke to a lot of people who are actually experimenting with UBI, and I had a lot of conversation with them, and I kind of explained to them about EOS and governance, because for them, it was totally new. They've just heard about Bitcoin, you know, something like that, you know?
Wow.
This is like people, you know, like people in different industries sometimes are so into it that they kind of like just don't know a lot of what's going on around them, right? So it's like,
what was the response? When you spoke to some of these UBI advocates and their first time starting to capture like mentally the implications of crypto.
Yeah, so the interesting thing is, so there was one who she had already done, I'm not gonna name names, right? But then one of the person I talked to, like she had already done some work with blockchain. She knew blockchain and she was actually already trying to integrate the two. So that wasn't like too much of like a learning curve. But then I did speak to like you know, some other people, and they've heard about Bitcoin, but then they were like, oh, it's so like anti-government, like, so does that mean like this Bitcoin people don't want government, like what is this, is it just used by like, you know,
they thought you were an anarcho-capitalist?
Yeah, basically. Okay. and then I was just like, oh no, I actually ended up spending like so many sessions and talking to her, and at the end of it, like she was writing a book, and now she wants to like get like quotes from what we were discussing, and she wanted to learn about governance, and then she's like kind of like, you know, she's definitely more interested, you know, about all of these other things that are happening. So
wow.
Again, the biggest insight for me when I did that was that, oh my God, if you actually start talking about governance, you are now suddenly getting this whole group of people who are first turned off by the lack of governance, you know? So
I mean, the major entities that stood to lose the most when Bitcoin hit the scene, you have politicians and banks.
That's right.
And so, whatever their pet programs or pet concerns are, I mean, I call them pet concerns. That sounds insensitive. And like you said before, I'm a little bit disconnected to politics and banking as such. I don't work for the FDIC or whatever.
Yeah. No, that's true. The great thing is, like, you see, like, you know, see, we all kind of have come from our unique backgrounds, and then this is something that's somehow managed to like bring in passionate people. You know, I'm doing my own way, and you're doing it in your own way, and like so many people are doing it in their own way. You know, like which other thing can bring all of these people together and kind of like, you know,
Freemasonry, maybe. No, that's not working.
Yeah.
Forget I said it. Sorry, I think I'm required to delete that last part.
You could totally edit it. Yeah, no, I think it's been fun. Like, I think so Bitcoin, blockchain, I think has an important role in doing things that corporations are like super not incentivized to do. Governments are too distracted to do. I think blockchain, if it's organized under some good governance model, I think they can do some very, very interesting things. They can set examples for governance or corporations to follow, you know?
Okay. Yeah, awesome. Well, totally agree. Salute. I mean, it's been a breath of fresh air having a conversation with you. And don't want to take all of your time from the evening because we're going about an hour. Yeah, an hour and 20 minutes. Thank you so much for spending the time with us, talking to us about Blockgenic, talking to us about EOS. For anybody who's lasted this long, first off, you're awesome.
Oh,
and
thank you.
Yeah, right. Thank you. It was a long conversation, maybe a little meandering, mostly my fault. But for anybody who's gone this far,
do that, so.
Where can people find you? Where do you want to be found? And where would you love for somebody from this video to hit you up and say, hey, so I love what you're doing and I want to contribute in some meaningful way?
Oh, I'm not super active on Twitter as much as, like, you know, Blockgenic is active. Obviously, we can follow a lot of what we're doing there. And then people can, email me, or like, I'm more than happy to, like, give you my email. if that's how they want to reach me, or
okay, then this email address you see right here, hovering right there at my beard. I guess where I'm going to put it. I guess. So Luke, thank you for your time. Thank you for being such a vocal proponent for these causes that are important to you. Clearly, at least with UBI. For my part, I was not super enlightened on them, and I wouldn't have been able to read more about it had it not been for you, because I'm within your sphere of influence. Thank you so much. Really appreciate your time. Really appreciate everything you've done.
Thanks, dude. And same for you. You know, like, I think you're doing a great job of, like, just kind of like, you know, you're so lively. So, you know, just keep this up and you will be converting more and more people. So,
yeah. Thanks. Me and Roger Burr, winning hearts and minds. So, Lou, thanks again.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.